Okay. Well, thank you guys for having me over. My name is Jeffrey Kussens. I'm a technology officer at ITQ. For those of you who don't know ITQ, we're a consultancy partner and we specialize in delivering consultancy professional services for VMware, AWS and Pivotal. Got any questions afterwards? My email address is in the slide. You can find me on Twitter and I occasionally blog on my personal website. You can find it over there. Technical deep dive. That's quite challenging, given that this is, quite a diverse audience. So if I go too deep or stay too high level, just shout out. If you guys have any questions, let's try to keep it interactive. Before I start with my deep dive content, I do want to amplify on some of the things that John already mentioned. And I think this quote by Andy Jassy, the CEO of AWS, really says it all. And all the encounters that AWS is having with enterprise customers, there's always one thing that's common, and that's there's already a big footprint in on-prem data centers. And you can't simply just ignore it. So, and the numbers back it up. There's been a Gartner study. There's still 70 million virtual machines running inside data centers. So with all the native cloud stuff going on, how do you cope with that? And that's obviously where VMware Cloud and AWS comes in. And I did a talk at AWS Summit in Amsterdam recently. I already also used this example there. These are the guys from A-Cloud Guru. They build a service platform for their online education and certification stuff. I think if you ever did an AWS certification, then it's highly likely that you visited their website. Great stuff. And on March 31st, they announced that they adopted a server. And a really funny story about they were walking around in a data center facility, and they saw all the poor servers in the data center, and they decided to adopt one. Well, that's April Fool's joke, of course. But these guys, they're doing a fantastic job. Don't get me wrong, but it's fairly easy for them. They started the company in 2015. So they had no on-prem footprint. They had no legacy applications. They could start with a blank piece of paper to design their platform. And that's quite different from, an enterprise or an existing customer that's already running a data center by itself. So John already mentioned some of the things that make cloud migrations complex, because I talk to a lot of customers, and I think the good news is that up until 2 years ago, I always had to convince them that the cloud was not something scary, but could be really helpful. And today, every customer that I talk to has no question in his mind. He is going to the cloud. The only two questions are when and with which applications. But cloud is there to stay, obviously. But what makes it so difficult to get from an on-prem data center into the cloud? And John, you kind of mentioned these. I'm going to run over them fairly quick, but it's consistency in the infrastructure stack. An EC2 virtual machine instance is an entirely different beast from a VMware virtual machine. There are lots of tools that can migrate your VMware virtual machine into an EC2 instance, but what do you get in the end? And how do you move back if you need to? Managing AWS can be quite challenging from a data center ops perspective. I obviously have a VMware background, took my Certified Solutions Architect Associate exam last year. It's quite a new world, I can tell you. So you need a different set of tools and skill set for your people that are managing your applications and your environment. You need to think in an entirely different way about governance, security, compliancy, that sort of stuff. And I think most critical of all, how are you going to meet your enterprise application SLAs in the cloud? If you just stick to a simple lift and shift migration, so you take your legacy virtual machine, you pick it up, and you put it inside a single availability zone, how are you going to meet your SLA in that scenario? I will touch on that a bit more in depth in a couple of slides. And last but not least, there are still a lot of people, they're kind of worried about putting all their eggs in one basket. And vendor lock-in can be mitigated, you know, on entirely different levels, depending on you know, the needs and demands of the customer. For some customers, it's okay to have, you know, kind of an exit strategy that's executable in maybe a year or something, that's adequate for that customer. And other customers, well, they need to be able to move out of a cloud environment, you know, within days or minutes or weeks or whatever. But you can mitigate this risk on entirely different levels. But these five factors, they make it really difficult for a customer to move to the cloud. Well, you didn't show this one already. Really interesting what you did with the 7R. but this basically is you know, how you in an ideal world approach a cloud migration. You start off with making a big inventory of all the applications that are running inside of your data center. And then you need to determine what are you going to do with all those applications. And that's where the 7Rs come into play. The most easy one, obviously, is you know, just retaining it, just keeping it where it is, keep it running. You have to do work. You have to retire it. You have to decommission it. If you just leave it running, that's the most easy part. But indeed, the next option is retiring. We're working at a big hospital on a project. They, in the first inventory, they had about 5,000 applications running. That included all the executables that are on local desktops and everything. But it's insane. They have so many apps running. So getting rid of a lot of them is you know, that's the best approach. But then with all the applications that are left in your basket, what are you going to do with them? Well, repurchasing, replacing, that's simply putting it in a SaaS service. That might be a good option. But then if that's not possible, you get different options. Rehosting, that's lifting and shifting. And that's where I see most of the people basing their cloud migration on. Just picking the virtual machines and the applications up and putting them inside a cloud instance. They're not putting any effort into optimizing the workload or the cloud infrastructure beneath it. They just want to do it with minimum effort. The second one is replatforming, and in that case, you kind of take the application apart on an infrastructure level. So, for example, replacing your Oracle database, you know, with RDS or something, or putting application load balancer in place, or you know, you're kind of making optimized use of the cloud infrastructure and the possibilities that are available there. And then the most difficult option, and that's in essence the royal route, refactoring or re-architecting your application. And that means really picking your application apart on a code level and rebuilding it as a cloud native application. But as you can imagine, that takes a lot of time and effort. So how do you decide, you know, which strategy is, you know, aligned with your with the workload at hand, with your migration plan? I really like the way that Pivotal is looking at this. Pivotal, for the guys in here that don't know it, they build cloud-native platforms, Cloud Foundry application services. It's basically a PaaS, and they build, together with VMware, they build Pivotal Container Services. That's based on Kubernetes, but that's not relevant to this story, but I really like how they approach this. So they're saying, push as many workloads as technically feasible and through business criteria to the top of the platform hierarchy. Well, first let's determine the hierarchy. I think you guys know it. Software as a service, functions as a service. It's a different name for serverless, but basically the same idea. Platform as a service, containers, infrastructure, and hardware. So now how do you determine on which level you need to place your application? That's where the business criteria factor comes in. For your strategic applications, and those are applications that are, you know, giving you a competitive edge or competitive advantage, don't put them in a SaaS, please. Your competition has access to the same SaaS service, so that makes no sense at all. So for critical applications, start at a serverless layer. You know, that's what Jeroen mentioned. That's where we want to be with, you know, all your important applications. If that's not technically feasible, drop down to the platform layer, to the container layer, infrastructure, and hardware layer. Well, makes sense, right? So how come if this is the well, the best way to attack a cloud migration, and we have the six R's to back that idea, how come most application migrations to the cloud stick to the IaaS layer? It really puzzles me. Well, I think there are two big reasons. Maybe there are more, but a lot of the applications are commercial off-the-shelf software applications. You just buy them from a vendor. You're not able to pick that up and recode it or anything. And you're not going to build or functionally rebuild a cloud-native application, mimicking an already-in-place application. So I think this is a really big factor why refactoring isn't always possible. And if it is possible, prepare yourself, because that takes a lot of time and effort, as you can imagine. So for lifting and shifting, we're just seeing that it's not maybe the best way to migrate your stuff into a native cloud. But I think there are also some risks involved. And I kind of already mentioned it. So who of you guys are running production workloads in AWS in EC2? Okay, a couple of them. Yeah. Did you guys read the SLA? Obviously you did. A lot of customers I talk to, they come from an infrastructure background. They have no idea that the SLA for EC2 is measuring the state of region unavailable. That means that two of those availability zones inside of a region need to be down in order for the SLA to kick in. So if you're picking a single instance virtual machine with a legacy application, and you're just picking it up and turning it into an EC2 instance running in a single availability zone, and you're not taking any other measures, then you have no SLA. And a lot of the customers that I talk to that are new to AWS have no idea that this is the case. So you're not only maybe getting the best migration strategy, you're also introducing a lot of risk. And what makes it so difficult to migrate those legacy applications or traditional applications? Well, if you pick apart an application, then you most of the times you will see three layers, right? A presentation tier, an application tier, and a data tier. The presentation tier, you can quite easily, more often than not, pick it, put a load balancer in front of it, and just put them in two availability zones. The data layer, a database, most often it has data synchronization options or whatever. You can easily put your data in two availability zones. The application layer, in my experience, is the most troubling layer, because that's very often a single instance VM. If the application itself doesn't have any capabilities inside of the application to replicate across availability zones, then it's really difficult to scale it across these two concepts. So this is all quite challenging. So just make sure that when you're migrating on a lift and shift basis into a cloud, think of your applications and if they can scale across these availability zones. Well, this all kind of leads up to the service, right? VMware Cloud and AWS. Customer data center running VMware technology, so it's there's vCenter server running. And VMC, that's the shortcut for VMware Cloud and AWS. It puts the same stack in an AWS data center. So you can really easily, extend your data center, migrate workloads. It's really easy, consistent. If your ops team is familiar with managing the VMware data center, then I'm sure they feel right at place in the VMware Cloud and AWS. John already covered this. You can extend into native AWS services. This is all really, really cool stuff. So kind of diving under the hood now. So how is the architecture built? If you look on this side, an on-prem data center with vSphere hosts. These vSphere hosts can either be running a standard switch or a distributed switch. If you're not familiar with the concept, it's not really important to the story, but a lot of VMware customers are under the impression that they need to be running NSX in the data center to be able to gain the benefits of VMware Cloud and AWS and the layer 2 extensibility. That's not the case. So just with standard vSphere networking, you can consume the service and integrate it in a hybrid cloud architecture. It also doesn't matter what kind of storage you're running in your data center. Could be vSAN, could be any other supported data store. The virtual machines obviously are running on this side. The content library of vSphere synchronizes your templates, your ISO files, your OVAs, whatever, you know, all the stuff that you use to deploy your workloads. You can synchronize it with VMC. Hybrid link mode connects both vCenter servers, so you can manage both environments from a single pane of glass. So if you look at your vSphere client when you're consuming VMC and you're using hybrid link mode, then you just see another data center inside of your management view. So VMC is running vSAN standard and it's running NSX. And the stack is consistent, as you can see. So any workload that's supported on vSphere is supported on VMware Cloud and AWS. It's as simple as that. I hope I got the numbers right, chill. there's a soft limit of 2 software-defined data centers per organization. It scales up to 10, right, if you talk to the right people. I think VMware is more than willing to scale it up. within each SDDC, there are 20 clusters, 3 to 60 nodes per cluster. And just to reiterate on the question that was asked before, it's an enterprise-grade solution. It's a premium service, so it does come with a significant footprint on in terms of compute and storage. Yeah. So looking at the numbers, 108 cores in a 3-node cluster, and about 1.5 terabit of RAM. And you can scale it up in a 60-node cluster to 567 cores and 8 terabits of RAM. So these are really, really hefty machines, really hefty clusters. So the i3 Metal, that was the first instance that was introduced by VMware and AWS. So again, it's not nested virtualization. It's bare metal running native ESX. And there are 8 self-encrypted NVMe flash drives in there. So it's really insanely fast storage. And they run vSAN on top of it. So dedupe and compression is enabled. And this is really, really, really fast. But one of the challenges with running a hyper-converged infrastructure that is based on vSAN is that it's really difficult to scale compute and storage independently from each other. And I think this is where where the magic and the really joint engineering effort from AWS and VMware comes into play, because they decided to introduce a whole new instance family running diskless headless servers, and they're using EBS block storage to run vSAN on top of. In my mind, that's the perfect example of combining a really scalable cloud service with data center technology. So it's a really good example. As you can see, there's a kind of different configuration here. But I think the most important aspect is being able to scale up your storage without having to necessarily scale out your compute capacity. And this is really, really beneficial for larger customers that have a really high storage footprint. Not really sure time-wise if I need to go into all the details. So am I going too fast, guys, or just trying to benchmark if stuff is making sense? Yeah? All right. So you can scale up Elastic vSAN, that's the product name, by the way, for the service in steps of 5 terabyte. So you go from 15 to 20 to 25, all the way up to 35 terabytes of storage capacity. Of course, you configure it when you create a cluster. Then you need to choose what kind of storage you want to use. It comes with compression enabled. And I think this is a really, really good solution for larger customers. I know there's a large insurance company that was looking at VMware Cloud and AWS. And if they just did the compute calculations, they needed, let's say, 20 hosts or something. And from the storage perspective, they needed 50 or 60 hosts. So there's a really big difference there if you have a lot of data. So just looking at how the process works of adding a host. Well, it's all there's a nice HTML5 client based on the new Clarity standard that VMware has developed. So it really looks like a really easy to use user interface. And how does the process work? You know, if you follow the wizard and you just decide to add a host, well, obviously the host is added. All the networking stuff is automatically configured for you, and the vSAN data store capacity is increased, and the host is added to your cluster. This takes about 10 minutes, and if you just, you know, imagine the kind of effort you needed to take in the old world, you know, getting a procurement order signed off, getting an RFP in place or something. You need to get a quote from a vendor. I think there was a study that it kind of took, on an average, 60 to 80 days to get a new server provisioned, racked and stacked in a data center. This takes 10 minutes. So it's really, we kind of step over this awesomeness really fast, but it's really cool what's going on. And auto-remediation. And I think, Tony, that was something that you were discussing, that you're not supposed to look at your on-prem footprint from a host perspective. And let's say I have 10 hosts running, then I need 10 hosts in VMC. That's not the case, and I will tell you why. One of the reasons is that if you consume a 10-node cluster, for example, you're always running 10 healthy nodes. If VMware is detecting that one of the hosts is failing for whatever reason, then the data is evacuated from the host, a new host is added to the cluster, and the defective host is kicked out of the cluster. So no more N plus one sizing or taking, you know, all kinds of things in consideration. You're running healthy nodes. And the second aspect, indeed, Tony, was if it only takes 10 minutes to add a new host, then why should you, you know, put a whole lot of spare capacity inside of your cluster? You know, you can really fast and easy scale up or scale out, actually. So you don't have to need to have all the spare capacity in your data center. So the consolidation ratio on an SEDC in VMC is really, really high compared to on-prem data centers. And then last but not least, auto-scaling for vSphere clusters. If you're a VMware guy, then this is really cool stuff, you know. Based on the load on the cluster, you can just automatically add ESXi hosts and scale down if the demand goes down. And this is really, really cool. You can have the option of, you know, optimizing for performance. So your bill will be a bit higher because it will be, you know, the algorithms are a bit more aggressive. So nodes are added to the cluster more frequently, or you can optimize for cost. And then the cluster is more conservative and hosts are not added as fast. So the SLA, indeed, on the single availability zone, is 3/9 of availability. Multi-AZ deployments, so stretching your cluster to environments, you get 4/9 of availability. And I'm not really sure if this is the official number, but, you know, conceptually thinking, if you put a second region in place and two availability zones together.
Change will not fit into that one.
Sorry?
This is commercial.
Yeah. No, this is more from a my take on, you know, thinking at it from an architectural perspective. Yeah. but yeah, in this case, you know, a regional impact will take down your cluster. Well, thankfully, these are really, really rare. I can't even remember that an entire region went down, John. So I think some of the global services might have some. Oh no, that was Microsoft, right?
Yeah. Sydney region some years ago.
Okay.
It affected more than one availability zone.
Okay.
It's really, really uncommon.
Yeah. It's really uncommon.
There was one 2 years ago in the US. Half of the country was down.
No, there was just S3 in the same region.
Yeah. Oh,
okay. One service in one region.
Yeah.
And you can see how much impact that has.
Right.
And that's why we spent so much time and effort in making sure that we don't have these multi-AZ events going on that impact more than one service. It's really critical infrastructure.
What's the one with GitHub going down?
I don't think it was.
No.
Yeah.
Another one.
And I think it's really fun, you know, if there is a single AZ failure, you can immediately spot, you know, on social media, all the guys that just, you know, took the approach of, you know, migrating all this stuff into a single AZ. And then AWS, of course, is saying, well, it's not my problem. You need to protect your workloads. So we kind of need to make a kind of a hit list on the people that are complaining on Twitter. and just engage them, because this is a solution for that problem. So if you have a legacy application and it's running, you know, on a really highly available cluster, stretch cluster or infrastructure in your data center, and you want to have it inside of a cloud solution, then this is the way to go, in my opinion. So moving on. We tried to prevent overlap between slides, but there's some similarity in there. So disaster recovery as a service. I think I don't have really much to add on top of what John already mentioned. Maybe a bit more under the hood, looking at what's involved. Site Recovery Manager, that's a product of VMware that's been around for ages. You use it to create runbooks to perform disaster recovery. You can test failovers. It's a really cool solution. And I think one of the big benefits, in my opinion, from a DR perspective, is that as a customer, you're always in control. So with a stretch cluster environment, is vSphere high availability that is automatically recovering virtual machines in the second data center, in the second availability zone. And that might be really, really fast, but a lot of customers, and especially customers that are more on, restricted to certain compliance issues and regulations, they need to be in control. So they need to be able to determine when the disaster recovery is performed. And this is also much better auditable. So you can create test run books, you can deliver logs to your compliance auditor. So this is a really different solution than vSphere HA. As I always explain to my customers, vSphere HA is, you know, across sites, is disaster avoidance, because you can vMotion all your virtual machines to the second data center if you know trouble is coming. And it's high availability across sites, and it's not disaster recovery. This is really on a regional level disaster recovery. So you can put asynchronous replication in place, keep retention on snapshots and that sort of stuff. So this is a much more granular way of protecting your data. Oh, and I forgot to mention, because there is some complexity involved in the concept, because Site Recovery Manager is, you know, tightly coupled with vCenter Server, and you're not in control of the vCenter Server instance inside of VMware Cloud and AWS. That's managed by VMware, and I think John already mentioned it. It's running even a newer version than you're running in your data center. So they needed to make some changes to loosen up, you know, the versioning and the versioning restrictions and opening up the API. So this will work regardless of what you're running, you know, in your data center. Networking. Well, I think I'm making up some time that we lost. So two really, really big concepts, Management Gateway and the Compute Gateway. And these are now backed by NSXT. So and NSXT is the newest version of NSX. And it provides all the network services that you can think of. So firewalling, VPN, micro-segmentation, port mirroring, much more. And it also delivers an endpoint for the Direct Connect and the VPC connectivity. So if you take a look at it on a more higher level, then you can see the Management Gateway running inside of the management cluster, Compute Gateway running on the workload cluster. And I think this is how it really, really works. So is anyone familiar with NSXT in the room? You don't get to show hands, you. I think John was also mentioning the T0 router, and those are all really specific NSXT concepts. Just think of the T0 router as kind of the provider router, the provider edge. And all the T1 routers that are connected to the T0s, these are kind of the tenant routers. So there's one management tenant, if I may call it that, and there's a compute tenant. I think we're still restricted to one compute. Yeah, there's no multi-tenancy yet. I think it's on the roadmap, hopefully. but all the customer networks are connected to the compute gateway, and the management network is connected to the management gateway, and the T0, so the provider router, is connected, taking care of all the connections across the VPC, back to your data center, et cetera. I think this is the one I mentioned here. That's a really brilliant guy who made this diagram. He's sitting over there. let's take a few minutes to walk through this diagram. So here we have the on-prem data center. It's connected through an internet VPN, and there's a direct connect to inside of the VPC. So all those connections terminate on the tier 0 router, so the T0. Beneath those are the management gateway and the compute gateway. And these are all virtual appliances running on what's called an NSX Edge node. And that's a virtual machine form factor. I guess it's not bare metal, right? No. In VMC? No. It's a virtual machine form factor. And it's running an HA. So if it's a stateful synchronization between an active Edge node and a standby node. So let me see, before I get lost. the management gateway obviously connects to all the ESXi hosts, and there are vCenter server, the NSX controllers, all the stuff that's needed to run your SEDC. This end side is the customer domain. So all the logical networks that you create are logically routed on the tier 1 router. You can have firewalling in place on a per virtual machine level. So you can have real micro segmentation inside of an AWS data center, just like you're running in your NSX backed data center. And this is a whole different way of thinking about firewalling. It's a whole different concept compared to just having an upstream perimeter firewall. This is really enforced on the virtual machine NIC, and it's policy based. So you can create really smart and intelligent security policies to protect your data. Moving up, so the Elastic Network Interface, the ENI, is a 25 gig direct connection into your customer account, and that enables you to access all these cool native AWS services. So migrating your virtual machines into VMware Cloud and AWS is awesome. You can, with the use cases there, you can evacuate your data center really quick. You can extend your data center, all the stuff that John talked about. But I think this is the most, as a guy who loves technology, this is the most exciting part, because just imagine all the possibilities that you can. Oh, Siri. Shut up. I think I disabled this, but yeah. Being spied on. And I see a kind of an Alexa device standing here. Don't know who that is. So the use cases that you can unlock by combining your traditional workloads with native AWS services, it's immense. Just think of a legacy Oracle database with valuable data inside of it. You can just live migrate it into an AWS data center and hook it up to all kinds of cool big data services. It really enables a lot of innovation where it's not possible inside of your data center. So these are all the options for connecting. So we have layer 3 VPNs over the internet. We have layer 2 VPNs. And as you can see, looking at the IP ranges there, these are layer 3 separated, and layer 2 is just an extension of your on-prem data center. So if you move a virtual machine inside of your SDDC running in AWS, then you don't have to re-IP your workload. So you can literally do a live migration of that VM without a user even noticing it. HCX, the migration technology that VMware is delivering, also extends your layer two networks. Direct Connect kind of has the same functional aspects, but it runs obviously over direct connection with much higher and guaranteed bandwidth and the lower latency. So that's what HCX basically does. It abstracts your infrastructure. Again, Siri. Need to remember to disable it. Yeah, and I think indeed it goes back to version 5.1, I guess, even. So 5.5.
Yeah, not for light migration, yeah. But for
yeah. So even if you have, you know, kind of a really out of date data center, why should you invest time and money in replacing the data center with a new vSphere 6.7 data center when you can just spin up an entire SDDC within an hour and a half, 2 hours, and migrating workloads? You can be done in weeks instead of building an entire new data center with a lot of capital investment. So it stretches the networks across sites, so you can migrate workloads while they're still on the same layer two network. And it really allows for application mobility. You can use, you can replicate all the data up in front. You can decide when you want to make the cutover into the data center. You can do a cold migration, all sorts of possibilities depending on the service windows that you have for the application and the options that you have. And this is the same diagram that John used. So abstracting away your data, your infrastructure layer, migrating workloads. There's also WAN acceleration in there, compression, so all kinds of intelligent stuff to make the migration as painless as possible. I think, Gilles, you have the hands-on experience with...
I will show a live demo.
Oh, cool. I will not say anymore. This was my last slide.